Good morning and welcome to all those who have gathered here to worship together, and a very special welcome to those who will be participating and watching later the recording of this service. We pray that no matter where we gather, we may experience God's love and God's presence, recognizing that nothing can separate us from God's love and from God's presence. So may we all experience that today. Last week I was reminded that I forgot to draw people's attention to the Nativity that has become such a beautiful part of our Advent journey. And thanks to Luella for that. If you get a chance, come and have a look. Each week the scene changes. Last week the angel appeared to Mary, and this week the angel appears to Joseph. And the story unfolds throughout the season of Advent. And so I invite you to come and have a look at that, or look online, because we will post photos online. We also light the Advent candles, and this week Jill and Jacques and Emily have done the reading for us. And so we listen to them doing the reading. It's great that others can participate even from a distance. And so we join with them even at a distance.
Last Sunday, we lit the first candle in our Advent wreath, the candle of hope. We light it again as we remember that Christ, who was born in Bethlehem, will come again to fulfill all of God's promises to us.
The second candle of Advent is the candle of peace. Peace is the word that we hear a lot. It is one of the things that we hope for. Christ brought peace when it first came to us, and he will bring everlasting peace when it comes again.
The prophet Isaiah called Christ the Prince of Peace. When Jesus came, he taught people the importance of being peacemakers. He said that those who make peace shall be called the children of God.
We light the candle of peace to remind us that Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and that through him peace is found.
Peace is like a light shining in a dark place. As we look at this candle, we celebrate the peace that we find in Jesus Christ.
Let us pray. Thank you, God, for the peace you give us. We ask that as we wait for all your promises to come true and for Christ to come again, that you would remain present with us. Help us today and every day to worship you and hear your word and to do your will by sharing your peace with each other. We ask it in the name of the one who was born in Bethlehem. Amen.
A candle is burning, a flame warm and bright. A candle of hope in the darkness of life. While angels sing blessings from heaven's starry sky, our hearts we prepare now, for Jesus is nigh. A candle is burning, a candle of peace, a candle to signal that conflict must cease. For Jesus is coming to show us the way, a message of peace humbly laid on the hay.
Just a reminder to those who will be joining us online that we will be serving communion together, and so at the appropriate time you are invited to share communion with us as we share together. But that will mean that you need to get the elements ready. So maybe during the next hymn, you might, if you haven't already, get your bread and your grape juice and be prepared to share with us in communion. Let's pray. Gracious and loving God, in our worship, we seek to be ready to meet with you. We prepare ourselves, we still ourselves, we organize ourselves to get ourselves in the right frame of mind. And now we come to you in prayer. We come with thanksgiving for the beauty of this day, for the wonder of life, for the fellowship of this place, for the freedom to meet and worship, and for the gospel message of this Advent season. So we rejoice with the universal church as we journey through Advent in worship and in faith. Make us ready for the coming of our Lord. But are we ready yet? Are we really prepared to meet you here? Are we properly ready for the wonder of the Incarnation? We look at how we are and who we are, and we wonder how we will look to you. We still wear our garments of sorrow and affliction, for life may have been tough for us this week, and the burdens we carry might be hard to bear. We're still dressed in garments of failures, promises made and promises broken, acts of kindness missed and acts of sinfulness offered. We are still clothed in unrighteousness and we're ashamed. We're still dressed in the garments of doubt and uncertainty. We are not perfect. We have so many questions that mostly we hide them under our coats of respectability, our jackets of strength, our coverings of faithfulness, our public image of certainty, while underneath we are shabby and grey. Are we ready? Are we prepared for you to look on us such as this? But just when we want to turn away in our shame, your message comes to us again. Put on the beauty of the glory from God, for you deserve my love, dear children. Put on the robe of righteousness, and don't be fearful of my wrath, for this is the message that comes from God. Put on your head the diadem of the glory of the everlasting, for you need no longer be ashamed. Ready? Yes, we can be ready, not through our own purposes, but by offering ourselves to you, Lord God. Not through our own efforts, but by believing that our God will show your splendor everywhere under heaven, even for the likes of each one of us. So now we can be prepared. Now we can look, you can look on us and smile. Now we can recognize again that you and your people are one. We pray all this in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray together as we say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We listen to the first of our songs, make way for Christ the King.
Make way for Christ the King. His splendor arise. Fling wide the gates and welcome him into your lives. Make way for the King of Kings. Make way, and let his kingdom in. He comes the broken hearts to heal, the prisoners to free. The deaf shall hear, the lame shall dance, the blind shall see.
Make way, make way, and let his kingdom in.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Luke's Gospel, chapter 3, and verses 1 to 6. Luke 3, verses 1 to 6. It was the 15th year of the rule of the emperor Tiberius. Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea. Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip was ruler of the territory of Iturea and Trachonitis. Lysanias was ruler of Abilene, and Annas and Caiaphas were high priests. At that time, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the desert. So John went throughout the whole territory of the river Jordan, preaching, "Turn away from your sins and be baptized, and God will forgive your sins." As it is written in the book of the prophet Isaiah, "Someone is shouting in the desert, 'Get the road ready for the Lord. Make a straight path for him to travel. Every valley must be filled up, every hill and mountain leveled off. The winding roads must be made straight, and the rough paths made smooth. All flesh will see God's salvation.'" Thanks be to God for this word to us. Now, the writer of this gospel, as you can see, goes to great lengths to set John's ministry in a very specific socio-political context, a very real and historical context. We're told about all these powerful rulers at the time, the Emperor Tiberius, Pontius Pilate, Herod, Philip. All of these names are thrown out of these great, powerful rulers. And then we're told not just about the political rule of the day, but the religious rulers as well. Annas and Caiaphas. But the interesting thing about Annas and Caiaphas is that they were high priests appointed by the rich and powerful Romans. And they were under the control of Rome. And so even the religious leaders and the religious system of the day represents the mighty Roman Empire. And in the midst of all these powerful people in the world, the word of God comes to John in the desert, in the wilderness. I remember when I was at college once, one of our lecturers, Dr. Rex Matty, read that part, the first few verses to us, and stopped at, "And the word of God came to John in the desert." And then he said, "How would you preach on that passage?" And nobody could think about how you preach on that passage. And then he spoke about this, that, you know, in the midst of all these rich and powerful people, the word of God comes to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness, Nochal. The great slogan of the Roman Empire was Pax Romana, the peace of Rome. That Rome was said to be about peace, but it was a peace through subjugation, a peace through force and violence, which doesn't really make sense. It was a false peace. And into all of this, John heralds something new and different. Not a political peace by force, but God's salvation. God's peace is not merely the absence of conflict. It's about life in all its fullness, for all flesh, for all of creation. It's God's intended life for all. In Hebrew, the word for peace is shalom, a word we've probably heard very often, but it speaks about God's intended life for us and for all of creation. And that's totally different to the peace of Rome, this powerful ruler who just took over everything. I often say that in Christ, God is turning the whole world upside down, or rather turning an upside down world right way up. In John's words, quoting Isaiah, God is leveling the playing fields. Every valley must be filled up, every hill and mountain leveled off, the winding roads made straight. Jesus often spoke about the first being last and the last being first. The world is broken. The systems are broken. God's peace is about the healing and transformation of these broken systems into a world where all flesh shall see God's salvation. And that salvation is wholeness and fullness of life. That's what it is. And not just at a personal level, but in a social level, political level, in the whole world experiencing the wholeness and fullness of life that God intends. We're told that John's ministry took place in the wilderness by the River Jordan. Now we need to recognize that the Jordan River was the place that the Israelites crossed over from death to life, from slavery to freedom. It was the point of entry into God's promise of abundant life, the land flowing with milk and honey. And throughout Scripture, the Jordan is this symbol of moving from death to life, of embracing God's promise and God's dream for us and for our world. The wilderness throughout Scripture was where God did the work of preparation for the life that God intended. And so the Israelites wandered in the desert for 40 years, a time of preparation, and then they crossed the Jordan and into this land flowing with milk and honey to experience the fullness of life that God intends. And so it's very significant that John preaches in the wilderness at the River Jordan, or in the area of the River Jordan. He comes to herald this new life that is found in Christ. Christ is the ultimate fulfillment of God's promise of abundant life for all. That's why he's referred to as the Prince of Peace, the fulfillment of God's promise of abundant life for all. In Christ, we find the life that God intends for all. At his birth, John's father, Zechariah, spoke these words from Luke 1, verses 68 to 79. John's father, Zechariah, was filled with the Holy Spirit, and he spoke God's message. Let us praise the Lord, the God of Israel. He has come to the help of his people and has set them free. He has provided for us a mighty Savior, a descendant of his servant David. He promised through his holy prophets long ago that he would save us from our enemies, from the power of all those who hate us. He said he would show mercy to our ancestors and remember his sacred covenant. With a solemn oath to our ancestor Abraham, he promised to rescue us from our enemies and allow us to serve him without fear, so that we might be holy and righteous before him all the days of our life. You, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High God. You will go ahead of the Lord to prepare his road for him, to tell his people that they will be saved by having their sins forgiven. Our God is merciful and tender. He will cause the bright dawn of salvation to rise on us and to shine from heaven on all those who live in the dark shadow of death, to guide our steps into the path of peace. In Christ, God has begun the work of repairing a broken world. And God invites us to continue that work until the day when Christ will return to complete that healing and transformation of all things. And so, just after John's message, he says, a little bit later on, do those things that will show that you have turned from your sins. Do those things. There's work for us to do. We are called to an alternative way of life. One of the commentators I read put it this way: we prepare for the fulfillment of Christ's purposes on earth by doing what he did. We prepare for God's kingdom by seeking it and God's justice first. He goes on to say, if we expected that God's purposes on earth, the fulfillment of Jesus' work in the world, were really going to happen, and we wanted in on the action, wouldn't we be doing things like these? Eradicating extreme poverty and hunger, achieving universal primary education, promoting gender equality and empowering women, eradicating toxic masculinity, reducing child mortality, improving maternal health, combating HIV/AIDS, malaria and other diseases, caring for God's creation, bringing people together around the world to do justice. That's what God's peace is about. It's not just a nice feeling that we have. It's about the healing and the transformation of all of creation. It's about living a different way of life. Another commentator said this: change is for change. Change of individuals is for change on a larger scale. Change for freedom, for justice, for peace. What Luke gives us is profoundly personal and political in the broadest sense. We are taken to the waters of hope to be immersed in renewal and revolution. That's what God is doing in Christ. That's what John prepares for and calls us to prepare for and to commit ourselves to. Get the road ready for the Lord. Make a straight path for him to travel. Every valley must be filled up, every hill and mountain leveled off. The winding roads must be made straight and the rough paths made smooth. All flesh will see God's salvation. Let's pray together. Gracious and loving God, you call us in readiness for the coming of Jesus to look to ourselves, that we might be properly prepared for Christ in our lives. But we cannot and should not live in isolation from others, separate from the needs and concerns that surround us, the hurts and anxieties. So we pray for others in the knowledge and the gratitude that right at this moment, other people might be praying for us. And so we pray for the church, for this congregation here, and for all who minister to one another in the community of the faithful. In the compassion of our caring and in the mission of the gospel, individually and together. May the peace of Christ bless us. May the love of Christ work through us. May the light of Christ shine in the darkest places. We pray for our community, our country, and our world. Bless with compassion and tenderness those we know who work tirelessly for the good of others. Bless with wisdom and character those who have responsibilities in government. Bless with purpose those who are leaders, teachers, and role models for us all. Bless with your strength those who walk the corridors of power and who make decisions for the good of all humanity. We pray for those in need, those close to us, those who struggle for direction, those who are no longer able to stand tall with purpose and commitment, those who are weak and frail, those who are ground down by worries and troubles. And in the silence, we name them before you. We name them, those you already know, and we leave unnamed those you also know. For we recognize that everyone is an individual under your loving gaze. We pray for ourselves as we prepare in thoughtfulness for the coming of Jesus, that we might be honest with ourselves and open to your grace and to the greater good. And we give thanks for the communion of saints, those who have prepared our way and have offered us their guidance and wisdom and example, that we might boldly walk the paths of righteousness and truth. Bind us ever with them, that we might journey on as one people under God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we prepare to share in these very ordinary elements that remind us of God's life given for us and the life that God intends for us and for all people, we listen to a song that prepares us for communion as we gather at your table.
As we gather at your table, as we listen to your word, help us know, O God, your presence. Let our hearts and minds be stirred. Nourish us with sacred story, till we claim it as our own. Teach us through this holy banquet how to make love's victory known. Turn our worship into witness in the sacrament of life. Send us forth to love and serve you, bringing peace where there is strife. Give us, Christ, your great compassion, to forgive as you forgave. May we still behold your image in the world you died to save. Gracious Spirit, help us summon other guests to share the feast, where triumphant love will welcome those who had been last and least. Then no more will envy blind us, nor will pride our peace destroy. As we join with saints and angels to repeat the sounding joy.
So we have worshipped God for God's goodness. We've given thanks for God's love and grace. We have confessed and repented of our sin. Let us then share in this symbolic meal of remembrance that unites us with God and draws us together as the family of God. As Jesus and his disciples shared their last Passover meal together, Jesus took some bread in his hands. Then after he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is a reminder of my body, which is given for you. Eat this as a way of remembering me." After the meal, Jesus took a cup of wine in his hands and said, "This is a reminder of my blood. And with it, God makes a new agreement with you. Drink this and remember me." The Lord meant that when we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we remember how his death and resurrection saves us from the power of sin and death, and how Christ Jesus gives us the strength as he lives with us until the day when he will return to destroy sin and death forever. And so let us remind ourselves of the heart of the Christian faith as we say together, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Let's pray. Gracious and loving God, as Jesus asked us to do, we share this meal together, remembering him. We ask that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would unite us as your family, no matter where we might be at this particular moment, and that together we might be united to Jesus in a bond of love and commitment to serving him in the world. Amen. And so when we eat the bread that we break, isn't that a sharing in the body of Christ? By sharing in the same loaf of bread, we become one body, even though there are many of us. And so let's pray together a prayer of preparation. Lord, we come to your table, trusting in your mercy and not in any good thing we have done. We are not even worthy to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are so amazing that you even ask us to eat with you at the table. As we share the bread and wine, unite us with Jesus, that we may forever live in him and he in us. Amen. We will be bringing the elements to you where you are seated, and I remind us that all are welcome at this table of grace, which is a free, undeserved gift of God's love. And so all are welcome to receive. As we come around and serve, just ask you to put your hand out and we will serve you and ask you to keep the elements until we've all received, and then we will take the elements together. And those who are joining us at home, you may want to get your elements ready for that moment when we share together. And so I call on those who are going to help me serve, if you would come forward. And so we take and eat the bread, remembering Christ. And we take and drink the cup, remembering Christ. There we go, we say together. We thank you, Lord, that you have filled us with the bread of life, given us a chance to renew our relationship with Jesus, and allowed us to be a part of your family. Jesus, you have given yourself for us. Now we give ourselves for others. It is your love that has changed our lives. May your love flow through us as we serve you with joy. Amen. We're going to close with the hymn, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace. You may want to sing along with us quietly where you are. Thanks to our choir for leading us. Let's pray as we prepare to make our lives available as a channel of God's peace and healing in the world. Let's pray. Gracious God, we bring the gift of our lives to you and the gifts that we offer as we leave, the gifts that we give in various different forms and ways, all of our lives. Take our lives and let them be consecrated to you and your work in the world. Take our gifts and use them as means of hope for those who hunger and thirst. Help our lips to praise you. Help our hands to serve you. Help our hearts to love you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so let's stand as we bless one another by saying the words of the benediction. They're on the overhead if you need them. And you may want to say it to the people around you as we bless those around us. And so may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Go in peace and may God's peace go with you. Amen.